Welcome to another King's Crusher radio show. Not radio show. No, King's Crusher Chess 24 Blitz Banter. So this is Sunday, 12:30 p.m. So it's slightly earlier than usual. We had a time saving time change recently in London. Might do a little book review at the end if you remind me. I've got six books to check out. Welcome to another King's. Maybe at the end of the show, well, after we've done 1.5 hours, I'll append a little book review. Because there was some talk about Mikhail Tal's book. I've got some other books here which I can show you and just briefly talk about. They're not recent books, they're classics actually. They're just classic books. I think you could be in any collection. They're not topical, they're not that time sensitive. So, okay, got challenges to go through. Let's go to the earliest list, earliest challenge. Okay. Hello, Alec Gorshkov. Let's try King's Gambit in the first game. Bit of fun. Not accepted. So if I can get my pawn, I'll have this f file to play with. Although I've put myself in a bit of danger here on takes. Well, that's not happened. Just wondering about queen f2, if taking with the queen was possible. I do wonder. Okay, casting queenside seems a good idea to me. This is crazy, maybe, but there's the G file. There's a G file. I'm looking at the G file. So I'm hoping I can do something with this road to the king here. So some ideas. I'm attacking ideas from this G file road to the king. Knight D5, Bishop H6. Doubling the rooks is always a good one, a classic one, just to double the rooks. Rook g2, rook dg1. I think yeah, this looks like a very comfortable attacking position. Well, can I do this? I've got to watch out for bishop g5, but I don't think it's doing anything here. Bishop g5, it's not possible. Bishop takes though. Okay, it's check, and then knight takes. There's queen h6 after. This could be a quick knockout blow. This could be a quick knockout with queen h6. Yeah. Okay, thanks for the game, Alec. Thanks for the game. So, hello, the next challenger, Mai Palsson. Hello. Yeah, as Tal once said, if you give like a road to the king to Tal, like an open line. Expect to be checkmated. No, so someone asked, what's, my favorite between Kasparov and Tal? I can't answer that because they're both really, I consider them both in the dynamic, aggressive school of chess, which, so I love them both actually because they're in that, someone I don't really go over the games of as far as world champions. Perhaps I should, I'm missing out on something, is Smyslov. I mean, he's renowned for squeezing out end game advantages and stuff, and I'm probably weak in that area. I'm probably strong in the areas I like, and probably weaker in the areas, or the world champions I don't particularly like. I don't know. That's probably not objective, right? Objectively, you want to just be an all-rounded player and not have any particular preferences, because as soon as you accumulate a preference, a stylistic preference, you've accumulated a specific weakness. Actually, and I think there are certain players that then will beat you more than others because they're giving you a style of game which perhaps you don't like as much, or they're taking your style of play into account. Smyslovian type players, probably. Smyslovian, maybe. Okay, so, but generally, whatever player you're playing, generally, style independent, I think. A lot of people, just any world champion, would agree. First thing is make sure you've got counterplay in the position. So whether you're, a positional player or attacking player, The key thing in one key thing in chess is to have counterplay. The pawn structure, make sure pawn structure is giving your pieces a certain amount of liberation and the opponents a certain amount of lock in where possible, one way traffic. So, but within that, you know, yeah, I should have gone through more games of other world champions probably, but on my channel, you know, the King's Cross channel, I have a big preference for Kasparov games and Tell games recently, very big preference. So Rook F5, Rook F8, I think from martial arts, was it Bruce Lee said to be like water or something, to be fluid like water, you know, not really expecting any particular bias of the battle ahead. All the different types of martial artists probably, you know, you can have different styles, but the more fluid you can be to a particular opponent in a particular context, then you know, the more effective potentially you can be. Now here, like Rook A, F8, Rook F2, Rook F2, Queen E3 is provisionally interesting, but there's like Queen E1 or Queen F1. To make this work, maybe Queen H2 there, and then Bishop H3 might be more making it work. There's also an idea, just basically an exchange sack here could be interesting. I'm tempted because the light squares are kind of weak, just to do an exchange sack. Although there's always F3 after, or is there? There's Queen E3. I do wonder. There isn't E6 if Rook F7. I could probably just play Rook F7 just to be on the kind of safe side, because the thing about this, it doesn't have to be about the king. This pawn's like kind of away from the other pawns. So I think I can just pressurize that pawn if I get a chance. I might do that instead, actually. Just keep my option open for this pawn as well, as the F-file, all the light squares. I thought I could just take here on that. That pawn went a bit sooner than I anticipated. Okay, so here, yeah, it's nice to be a pawn up. Okay, so doubling the rooks, Queen H3. Is looking like an attacking position, a nice attacking position. Don't seem to have to worry too much about losing too many pawns on the queen side at the moment. The question is here. What is the question here? It's probably h5, h4 takes, and then something after that. If takes, then they're taking f1. If takes this way, probably rook f5 to h5. Okay, let me see. Rook f6 to h6. Might not even need to use this h pawn. Well, that's another pawn I'll take, I think. Now, I know that the rook's defending, so I can't do queen g2 mate at the moment. That would be a slight mistake, to say the least. So can I just, for the moment, I wonder if I can just bring the rook out for a moment. Just so rook h6, that would tie down the rook, so there's no rook f3. Also interesting to consider, but not very much, is rook g6, because there's rook f3, there's no time for that. For the moment, I don't need to do anything too rash, actually. I'm just going to be calm here, protect this, and just use the H pawn. Whilst this is protected, this pawn chain just is asking to be undermined. I noticed when studying a lot of Kasparov games, fundamentally, he's often just going initially to weaken the pawn chain, the immediate pawn chain around the opponent's king. And the same with Tell. Although Tao usually does it with a magnificent sacrifice, just takes away all the defending pawns around the king. It's a common thing. Here, I wonder if I can use my king whilst holding f3 to get leverage for g5, which would give my king h4. I think I can take this calmly at the moment. Is the G fault a problem? Or am I going for a funny self-mate? That's the thing. It's a bit of committal. There might be a less committal way of playing this, because although it would be funny to have a self-mate, there might be an element of regret after. So there must be a very calm way of playing this. Just to minimize counterplay, would be just keep hold of f3 and probably walk the king safely to e4 when getting the chance. If I had the king on e4, then that position would start to be tricky without so much of a self-mate opportunity. Okay. Okay, thanks for the game, Milparson. Okay, so butterfly. Hello. So Muhammad Ali's quote I mentioned before. His nickname is it float like a butterfly, sting like a bee? Yeah. Okay. Now I'll try and play a respectable black opening here. But I thought c4 was going to be played. Now we've gone into a French defense. Fine. Okay. This line is interesting. I'm just wondering about the F file dynamics. They seem attractive at the moment. The F file dynamic play. One thing, little trap, is on bishop h4, you can't castle because of bishop h7. King takes a knight g5. Knight d5 is threatened. I will castle, but if this bishop moves, bishop h7 is threatened for king takes knight g5. Now here, the e5, I think knight d5, queen d5, bishop c4. So my king's not yet safe. Much. I'll try and risk doing this, but yeah. I can't play e5. And e6 is vulnerable, so maybe I'm gonna risk this move to facilitate e5 without knight d5. It's not necessarily happening. There's bishop a3 here, actually. If my queen was on f6, there would be bishop a3. Pardon me. Oh dear. Oh, there's knight h4 to g6 coming. Oh, this is going to be fun. Right. e5, knight e5, knight e5. Is e5 possible here? Not really. It's g5, it's going to be fun. Bishop e7 to stop knight h4. Doesn't look like. Very interesting position at the moment for me. What about knight d4? I can do knight d4 to try and extinguish this knight h4 to g6 threat. Probably. I hope. Because that is very threatening. My light squares have been compromised at the moment. Bishop b6, knight d6. Bishop c5, knight c7. Maybe that's a less evil move. Knight d6 is a bit of a pain. Tricky. Let's get concrete details of the position here. Is knight c5 possible without getting hammered? There's knight d6. As long as I don't get mated on h7 in a hurry. I'm a bit conscious of these light square weaknesses. Okay, is queen e7 possible? Or queen f6? Queen f6 says bishop e5. What I want to do here. Okay, interesting. Is bishop c7 possible? There's knight f5. There's already knight f5. Oh, that's a relief, because I thought knight f5 was dangerous actually just now. This gives me some activation. The knight was more dangerous as it was, or maybe coming to f5 at some point. Actually, okay, so what are my light squares of the week? Knight a4 and queen b4 could be interesting, hitting b2 and threatening knight c3. Meanwhile, bishop e5 pins this, meaning queen d2 to h6 would be useful. I could just take that off and rook f5. Yeah, this gives me rook f5. I don't like the opponent having pieces like that bishop on d3 pointing at the king. Rook d5 is threatened potentially. Right here, he's given me a pawn, that f2 pawn. I'm on c2. Yeah, that was a mistake, I think. Now, I don't want to give the f file too quickly, but on the other hand, well, maybe this, I can't do that. I don't want to give the f file on the plate in a blitz game because it's difficult to handle dynamic play, basically. I'd rather have dynamic play. You see, rook f1. Okay, oh, okay, I'll take that. Okay, if bishop a7, b6, I'm going to get rid of this bishop, I think. Right, there's rook d5 happening. I'm taking another pawn, hitting the bishop. Yeah, a few mistakes there from a great position actually. Thanks for the game, Butterfly. I think the knight on d6 had some great attacking potential. The tension of the possibilities of that knight on d6, I think, could have been explored rather than the immediate knight takes c8. Okay, so Geordie Sonisk, hi there. Did I wonder if he ticked the box for creating the game? There's a tick box, I think, somewhere when you challenge. Should we just abort this particular game? Maybe he can challenge later. Right, if we can challenge later, try and remember the tick box, guys, for creating the game. Azor Mist, hi there. Yeah, I'll stick with Smith Mora at the moment. Probably I shouldn't pre-move, right? I shouldn't pre-move. Just make sure what's happening here. Is it like knight f6? Mind you, knight f3 doesn't seem such a bad pre-move, even on knight f6. D5 might be better to take here. Okay, so knight takes, and now here the light squares seem a little bit sensitive. The question is, how sensitive does it actually matter that much? If I Castle and e5 at some point. I'll be disrupting that knight. Disrupting the knight immediately is interesting, probably. The simple thing might be to take on d4 at some point as well. Okay. And now what happens? The knight, where is the knight moving exactly? If it goes to e4, knight takes d4 for knight f5 might be interesting. Okay, this one for rookie one. Right, it's a fishing pole attack. As I say, in blitz games, I think I prefer having the dynamic play, even if it's objectively okay to do this. I don't like give too much dynamic play in a blitz context, because ideally, with limited time, you want the sort of bias, in my view, to easier to play positions rather than say positions you might have a material advantage, but are trickier to play. I mean, I guess it's the trickiness, the resourcefulness within chess positions, that make the game very interesting. Otherwise, we'd all be following sort of generalized rules and templates and being very successful and probably not wanting to play after. But it's the trick, it's the resourcefulness of chess, the difficulty of playing certain positions. And but ideally, you want to be like having the like dynamic play. You want to be the side with dynamic play, I think, the more like the time pressure is. I know with like engine evaluations, that it's in conflict with, and I've done videos about this. It's in conflict with, thanks for the game, Azumist. There's a conflict between like engine evaluations and how easy they are actually to, for a human to play. Because the engine evaluations assume like they're playing against other engines and they can play like 100 perfect moves in a row, but you want ideally positions that it doesn't matter if you've got an advantage, and it doesn't matter if you play like inaccurately after, because you're just human, right? So you sort of fact we've sort of try and factor in our own limitations within our evaluation of certain positions. So although objectively you might have a material advantage, it might be a difficult to play position. I've done a few videos about this. I think they're quite interesting. But I think that's why coaches are so good, because they'll try and steer you to such positions, whilst if you just had to review like your over the board games just with an engine, all you'll get is engine evaluations, right? And I think that's definitely like, for me, it's got to be like factored in to sort of the easiness to play. And that's the thing about, for me, the thing about gambits in blitz, the good ones like the Smith-Morra have this tendency to get positions that are kind of easier to play, although objectively it might be a pawn down. I mean, that's a classic kind of example. I haven't found that personally so much with the Benko Gambit. When I've played the Benko Gambit, sometimes the opponent just wins with the extra pawn on the queen side. I don't know, I'm playing it wrong. But yeah, other gambits, I've had worse though. And you can end up with difficult to play positions as well as a pawn down, like with the Albin Counter Gambit. So yeah, that's probably to be avoided generally. I mean, yeah, there's this sort of intersection between those gambits, that the more sound ones that do offer this easy to playness, and don't compromise like a whole color complex, like weaken all your light squares. When you play the Albin Counter Gambit, you're often weakening all your light squares. And that actually ends up making the position more difficult to play if you don't get particular types of attacking schemes worked up. Yeah. So anyway, so here, okay, I mean, it seems as though what's happening in this position anyway? Okay, knight e5 here. I've got a loose, semi-loose pawn on h5. Maybe knight f7 is something to be on the lookout for as a forcing move. At the moment, I don't think it does too much. Queen e6, king f8. Then what? Then what? Exactly. There's nothing. But the thing is, with such a forcing move, or forcing moves in general, I think even the outrageous ones, if you're constantly on the lookout, it's amazing how rapid the conditions for a forcing move can change. And so by anticipating even the outrageous ones in advance, like here, you know immediately the conditions of that outrageous forcing move have changed, right? And here it seems as though knight f7 all of a sudden actually works, because the knight on d5, that weakness of the last move, he's just weakened d5. Yeah, it's amazing how often that is the case. So paradoxically, to an observer, if they looked inside your thinking for forcing moves, which obviously you can in mine, I mean, yeah, it would seem as though I'm an idiot if I consider, right, these ridiculous forcing moves. But the thing is, because things can, the conditions for a forcing move working or not change so rapidly that it's not actually that idiotic. You're more sort of, it's like writing little sticky notes to yourself in advance of conditions changing to make that particular like forcing stuff like working. Now here, I mean, it does seem to be working here. In fact, g8 is protected by that bishop, but f7, okay, how does he defend f7? I have actually got video, quite a number. It's one of my favorite subjects actually, forcing moves. They're a very, very special type of move, because the tree, if you looked visually at the variation tree, thanks very much, TegJess79. Visually, just even from a visual perspective, the tree of variations, Kotov introduced, you know, having a look at the trees of variations and stuff. But for a forcing move sequence, it's quite easy to calculate several moves in advance, because the tree is like very straightforward. In more complex positions, I mean, so that's fascinating. You're basically going from one position by force to another. So they're the kind of high priority things to check out in any position, whatever your stylistic tendency is, whatever, you know, if it's Smirnov Hotel or Capablanca, everyone's like checking out the forcing moves, because you're forcefully transitioning a position to another, and that isn't totally ideal to me, a non-controversial use of calculation. But in more sophisticated positions, that also gives rise, in my view, and also to this GM on YouTube, to the most common type of mistake, is also as a side effect of this tendency to be tactically orientated. Because if you're tactically orientated, you're always on the lookout for, you know, control. So you try and control the position by looking at all the forcing stuff. The thing is, there is these small downsides that creep in when you check out forcing move stuff. I mean, I could check out bishop d3, but the small downside, I'm developing my opponent's pieces. So in more sophisticated type positions, you know, you have to be aware that the forcing moves aren't that great. You know, they're giving the opponent something. And whatever you do in chess, you don't want to give the opponent anything unless absolutely forced to. So here, I'd rather take on d3 without queen d3. Bishop b4 doesn't work, ab, but it's an outrageous thing to consider. And in a long game, you probably should. Any forcing move, you should consider knight e5. Bishop e5, it's not working, right? But these are conditions which they're so rapidly evolving in chess. It's worth checking out the forcing moves, even ridiculous ones. But by the same token, you don't want to play forcing moves that give any type of little concession to the opponent. And the most common type of that little concession is often untangling or increasing the activity of the opponent's pieces. By the way, I think he's just trapping my bishop by force. G4. Talking of forcing moves. Oh dear. Oh dear. What have I done? I'm going to try and provoke some weaknesses and hope for the best. There's F3, trapping my bishop by force. Yes, very nice. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. Oh, that isn't that funny? So back to work here. Okay. Oh, I'm hoping there's some weaknesses here to tap into. That's all I can say. He hasn't won the bishop yet. Why hasn't he won the bishop yet? Okay, is there B2 or BC? Can I do this? Queen D2, B takes C, or not? Okay, I'll pick up another pawn for a moment, or maybe here, just another pawn. Not too clever. All I'm wondering is, he's given me a little bit of something, I think, in terms of weaknesses. There's some weaknesses over here. I'm hoping there's a little bit of something. Try and hem this knight in for a moment. The knight's good on e4 for a moment. Although not for too long. I'm down on the clock. Yeah, there's a check. I don't even have to castle now. Okay. Oh dear. Okay. D4 for Queen D5 is forcing, but there's no Bishop F3 there. It's something to bear in mind. D4 for Queen D5. I'm also a minute down on the clock here. I'll do this, I think. Try and get a pin. If I can get a pin, I'll be happy. Also, I'm hitting b5 there. So there's no bishop f3 without losing b5. I wonder about. Ah. That's forcing moves, though. The problem is the f file. Oh, it's better than before, though. There's rook a3 here as well. See, in a way, he did give me a little bit of something. Although forcibly winning the bishop, there were some weaknesses. The thing is with weaknesses, sometimes you've got to open up the position to exploit them. Rook a3. There's also a pin, not just here, but here. So rook d8. Or bishop c5. Bishop c5 might be better because, or is it? Probably not. Hold on. I doubt it because I think he had bishop e3 hitting. I want to pin that bishop basically to the queen. And I don't want to spend too much time chatting about this position because I'm going to end up losing on time at this rate. But apart from that, everything's fine. Okay, queen takes f3. Right, things are looking a little bit up for me at the moment. As long as I don't get mated on G7, I'll be happy. Or D8. If I play the check. Takes d4, protect d8. Nearly a stalemate, but I think there's g5 or king g3. Oh, that was tense. Yeah, no, the only thing I can say, I suppose you gave me a f there were a few weaknesses around, but it was a bishop up, so I'm sorry. It was a good demonstration of, yeah, forcing moves to win a bishop, but there was a tiny little bit of something given to me. Oh dear. Oh dear. Okay, anyway. Okay, so yeah. See, that's great. I lost the bishop by force. Yeah, basically. Okay. Hi there, Siebenstein. Let's play King's Gambit. No one's accepting the King's Gambit. That's good news, because this is okay. So, knight c3. If I stop bishop g4, sometimes this is a terrible idea, but I'm hoping it's justified here. Knight f2, rook f1. Knight d4, I could probably take, and then queen g4. Knight d5 for c3. Knight d5 for c3 could be interesting. Because knight d5 basically unblocks the c pawn. And c3 is useful to control d4. Okay, so knight d5 for c3 might be an idea. If I'm concerned about d4. All right. Should I be worried? Bishop goes back for knight f2, but I play rook f1 there. I'm not sure I should mind about my king displacement because there's other factors in the position here that I kind of like. I mean, maybe d3. I don't know if it's easy to explain. But this is a kind of bind on the knight squares right now. Meaning, well, one example, bishop g5, knight d5, and the bishop's not helping f6. Against the king displacement, I mean, I think it's offset here. So bishop g5 and knight d5 could be very interesting. Especially there, definitely pinning that knight. So knight d5, I mean, I wouldn't even have to have the immediate, I don't have to immediately even double the pawns. If the queen goes back, I could hold the pin in place. Not an absolute pin, you know, relative pin. The absolute pins are like legal, you know, against the king, but so I have to watch out for the knight moving. But knight d5, queen moves, c3, just to try and A, it gives my king c2. B, it might be useful for either b4 or d4 later. So knight d5 followed by c3, then king c2. Okay, now here, okay, now it's changed. I have to do something about that. Knight d5 here. So c3 is not as effective as I mentioned. I can win c7 here and the rook. The thing is, any naughtiness, I can't see any naughtiness in return. Just before doing that, I could play bishop f6 just to make that a bit more effective, I think, because just in case, just in case that knight's gonna be naughty. I don't know. Just think that naughty knight which on f6. Now I'll just win the rook here. I don't think there's any other pieces basically helping the queen here now. Okay, so queen. Okay, bishop d5 can stop bishop b7 even. I mean, maybe that's worth doing. I mean, possibly. I guess king moves and bishop moves, and then all of a sudden, well, the knight's still protected by the bishop, actually. Okay. Now I can try and trap this bishop here with b4. Or munch it with knight takes b6. That knight's able to munch it there. Now, queen f4 just to simplify. Oh, doesn't mind. Okay, thanks there, Simsden. Okay, hawk. Hawk's layers. No, hawk's layers. No, hawk slayers. I think sounds more aggressive to say as hawk slayers, but on the other hand, I like hawks. I think they're a kind of noble creature. God, does someone really want to do something to hawks, like hawk slayers? That's cruelty to animals, isn't it? I don't understand the nickname. Maybe you can explain the nickname. It would be nice to know the origins of these nicknames. So this is kind of a hack attack, like H5, obviously. And I'm tempted just to try and open things up, you know. Yeah. In fact, knight h5, yeah. And bishop g5, f6 still opens things up in such a way that might be interesting in any case, because when there's this flank move like this, I mean, the classic recipe is to counter a flank attack with an attack in the center. I think I've read that a few times in Kotov's books as well. But here, okay, it's not doing anything at the moment, and in a way, the g4 has been compromised. I could plonk a bishop on g4 for what it's worth, or I could just go for. I think I'm going to go for trying to improve the effectiveness of this diagonal. So a5 and b4, just to try and blast through here, this pawn chain in close proximity to the king, just to undermine this pawn chain with a5 and b4. But the thing is, with that sort of plan, it might not work at all well in certain cases, because okay, here g4 clearly. If I play bishop g4, well, it's pinned. So yeah, bishop e2 is a nuisance because then it's still pinned to e2. Knight h2 is bishop d1. So in other words, I think I've restrained g4 for a moment. But coming back to this plan of a5 b4, I don't think it works very well because of c4 basically. So might have to go for a3 instead. On the other hand, there's an e4 plan now to factor in. But doesn't that just give the f4 square? So, okay, let's see. E4, isn't there like knight f4 there? Or just b4 anyway, and then accept c4. I mean, in principle, it's opening up the diagonal to do this. So does c4 matter? Can I not just unravel, I mean, not unravel, undermine, not just pawn chain, but dark squares generally? It's like undermining the dark squares here to play for a3. I'm playing for a3 or c5. Trying to undermine these dark squares with a3. Yeah. I take here. Then there's knight f4. I can jump into f4. Also, after knight f4, there's even queen a4. But I think the main focus is like a3, just try and undermine these dark squares. So a3 and knight f4 are ideas coming up. On rook takes, yeah, I'm wondering just knight f4. So on takes, I mean, there's also rook c8. Yeah, it looks as though there might be an overload situation coming up. Knight takes d3 is also interesting for rook c8. And on knight c4, there's rook c4. Because if queen c4, there's queen b2. I think there's an overload situation for b2, you know. This battery is pointing at b2. Where's the queen go? Knight c4, rook c4, forcing moves again, you see. They work here like clockwork, the forcing moves. They don't give any advantage to the opponent necessarily. So that's winning a piece. Yeah. That's the thing, you've got to distinguish between forcing moves which give something to the opponent and the ones which just transition to a different position you might want to check out, and it's non-controversial. You haven't done anything too controversial by following at all that forcing move sequence. B3 for A3 is a strong passed pawn, it seems. For A2. Okay, thanks. Hawk Slayers. I don't know how to say your name, but please tell me on the chat. Okay, this is getting ridiculous each week. Okay, thanks. Okay, anyway, on to the next challenge. Okay. Play a Sicilian fence. Now here the d4 square is pronounced in this structure as something I want to revolve my immediate strategy around, undermining the d4 square. That could involve taking on f3, but I don't like too often to give up bishops that easily. Another classic recipe for d4 is often knight e8. Holding d4 immediately, and with the further idea of knight c7 and this little dance maneuver. So knight c7, and then something like knight e6, holding d4 even more tightly. In the meantime, watching out for b4, Okay, so here, interesting, I'm getting entrenched on d4. This looks like a classic kind of stuff you'd want to do. The idea of bishop g4 is more tempting to me, in fact, now for some reason than earlier. Probably it could have been played earlier. If I get the rook out of the way of the bishop, that means any e5s are not going to be too that a little bit less effective in most cases. And then also the rook not just getting out of the way of the bishop. I can play b5, trying to loosen white's control of the d5 knight. Now I think I want to keep a piece there on d4. If I put a pawn there, it's not really, well, in the specifics of the position, it might be sometimes blocking the knight from going back, but the knight has f4 anyway. So having the bishop there is a nice central bishop, useful later, I hope. I can kick this knight. It can go to f4. And okay, I don't want the position too closed, actually. Although b4 has a certain temptation to it that, yeah, I think with b4 I'm intending e6, bishop b7, and what I want to do here is put a battery along this diagonal and play for f5. So bishop b7, queen moves, bishop c6, queen b7, maybe rook here, and then f5. But the plan is obviously evolving to what my opponent's doing here. He's rapidly changing the whole structure again. Bishop b7, bishop c6, queen b7 remains interesting to me at the moment. Because it's not only about central influence, this pressure on this diagonal leads to the king in this particular position. So here, something like f5 is trying to not just undermine central control, but it leads a pathway to the king as well. So there's two elements coming together, king safety and central control. And you see that in some of the games. There's a classic game I've mentioned before, Fischer against Tal. Well, Tal had a fantastic game. This is just losing a rook. I could consider a queen sack as well, just to make things interesting. Takes check. If there was bishop d4, but the d4 is covered. But I'm just taking the rook, right? Let's not play with the food, like the cat playing with the mouse. Let's just eat the mouse. Well, although cats don't usually eat the mice, they usually just bring them round as a sort of token. Oh, look what I've done today. I've torn to bits this mouse. Yeah, that's a different subject. Sorry, I'm getting onto a different subject there. Okay, cat cruelty. Speaking of which, there's a good film about a stray cat on the cinema at the moment. I did want to see it, but didn't quite last night. About this stray cat, it's got an 8.1 IMDb rating. This homeless person, he had his life transformed by this stray cat, ginger stray cat. Has anyone seen that yet on stream? I do. I would like to see it at some point. Okay. So anyway. All right, let's go for this B3. Okay, can I do this? Just because I'm mean, I don't want to lose my pawns necessarily all the time in every game. Okay. I'm gonna just protect this C5. Just, I don't know, I've just been mean here. Okay, thanks for the game. Right, Kramnik students. Now, I remember you're good against the King's Engine defense, so I'm not gonna play the King's Engine against you. Now, is that naughty? Is that not in the spirit of this stream? I'm hard coding my game to a particular opponent's already, but you're a very good player, you see. So I'm wondering if I should just avoid the King's Engine, you see. You want to play against the Benko Gambit instead? Yeah, for a laugh. Let's play against the Benko Gambit. A relative of the King's Engine, sort of. People play that, and I'm wondering, are they aware that to me that is offering an immediate aesthetic satisfaction of all the dark squares becoming weaker? And I'm just imagining all these delicious recipes using the dark squares for delicious dark square combinations. I don't know if people think like that, but I do. When I see F3 here, I'm thinking the dark square is going to be fantastic later. I'm probably over-optimistic already. Yeah. Anyway, sorry. Yeah. Just okay. So A6, and sort of Benko Gambit with extra dark square weaknesses, it seems. Okay, so Queen A5 might actually be an interesting move as well. One of my colleagues, Chess Explained, has got a repertoire book, Chessable, worth checking out on Benko Gambit. And I've just started it myself, actually. He's also a streamer here, actually, on Chess24. And he mentions a lot of Queen A5 lines. Well, not in this particular position, but sometimes it acts as a disruptive check. From a positional perspective, Black's pawn chain is on dark squares here. The Queen A5 sometimes is a disruptive check. Obviously not here, but if it pulls back a bishop, it's interesting. I wonder. Am I going to be a nuisance with this Queen A5 or not? Or is it just a way of self-trapping my queen rapidly? The other thing about this position, sometimes this battery actually does lead tactically to some disaster on A1. Sometimes A takes, not here. Now, is Queen B4 too risky? It's a little bit too committal for my taste, at the moment. Because once the Queen's in there, it can be difficult to extricate it, and the chances of the Queen getting trapped, are going up, aren't they? Basically, we can. I'll get my pawn back, a pawn back. I'm hoping for some counterplay, Benko Gambit style. But to me, this counterplay isn't as aggressive as, say, the Smith-Morra Gambit. It's more positional sort of counterplay, longer term for an end game. Some sort of end games in the Benko Gambit, you can be a pawn down and fine. Because this structure isn't too sometimes liberating for the pawns to actually generate an actual effective passed pawn. So I suppose that's one of the positional considerations. Does white actually get, white sometimes gets a, you know, what I'd call effective passed pawns, but sometimes it's not. I just want to make sure B4, I don't want to lose the rook, but I want to make sure B4 is not possible, otherwise an effective passed pawn will be created. Whilst an effective passed-pawn is not created, there remains some positional queenside pressure. The dog approves. Downstairs. Okay, I can hear her barking. Okay. Yep. There isn't an effective extra pass pawn at the moment still. So there exists some b-file pressure. In fact, sometimes a willingness, and it seems crazy, you don't usually want to do this as a general rule, exchange off when your material down, but because there isn't an effective real passed pawn, it seems as I've got beautiful coordinated pressure at the moment. At the moment, I know that can change at any time. At the moment, it looks as though it's nice coordination and pressure. Now, knight a6, knight b5, for example, changes things, because then if the knight can be reinforced on b5, that's not good. I think I'm going to go for it actually tactically. I'm not sure this is working because the knight b4, bishop b4, rook b4, knight c3, bishop b5, knight b5, rook b5. Now here, knight b5, there's rook e4, right? All right, what's happening here? Now on knight b4, knight c1. Now, I'm doing something with this position, I think. Knight b4 would stop an effective passed pawn. And it, I would say this is uncomfortable for white. The thing is, how would I actually increase the pressure? I can bring a knight to d4 here. I actually, believe it or not, played Super Grandmaster Michael Adams, Lloyd's Bet Masters, in the 90s. And he played a Benko Gambit. And this is the really, really weird thing. I really felt a total honor to play him. I really didn't mind losing at all. I just felt the whole experience was probably even worth just playing in the tournament to play this Grandmaster. It was worth playing in the tournament just to play him. And it was in the Benko Gambit. And he played this maneuver, knight e8 to c7 to b5 to d4. Yeah, I just remember that quite vividly. It's in the Chess Games Com database if you want to check it out. Gavriel against Adams. It's my long game against Adams was in the Benko Gambit. I should probably play it more, actually, come to think about it. Myself with black, yeah. It is a bit of fun when it goes right. But okay, here, I think he's almost creating a real passed pawn. This is a bit of a worry. Can I kick the king back? I don't want b4 to happen. Don't tell me b4 is happening. I don't want knight b5 to happen either. Finally, some tactical mistake, because there was pressure. I mean, this goes back to the other subject about easy to play positions. Sometimes the pressure does lead to a mistake that you've got on the queen side. Sometimes, otherwise, there's not much worth playing the Benko. It doesn't give you pressure. But thanks for the game, Kremnik student. Okay, MGTOW. MGTOW, hi there. I'll turn on the auto commentate maybe towards the end of the session. Should we try another Banco Gambit? Since it's been allowed. You guys are venturing out of the London system today. The London system is all the rage at the moment. Or maybe it's just against me on all my streams that people are thinking, oh, London system. I know London's a great place, but the London system is not the entirely the most exciting opening ever to play all the time anyway. But it is rock solid and reliable. Anyway, I'm grateful for when D5 is played. You see, D5 has also undertones of dart square play. When someone plays D5, you know, the dart squares again. Dart square pawn chain, dart square delight. It is my move, yes. I right, so we've got another echo of this. Is white going to generate a real pass pawn or not? If white is not able to generate a real pass pawn, I might potentially have nagging queenside pressure, which results in my opponent losing to some sort of queenside pressure based tactic. As Nigel Short has said, blunders are not usually in a vacuum. And if you have a position which is easier to play with pressure, hopefully you're kind of creating the right climate for some sort of tactical blunder. I think b4 was possible. B4 was possible here. My opponent is going to generate a real passed pawn, but hold on. There's a flaw in this position. There's a flaw. I've just noticed a slight flaw with my opponent's play. D5 has been neglected. Yeah. What's going on here? Knight d3. It looks likely that a real pawn that is going to be created with b4, though. I have to admit. I mean, I have to, unfortunately, reluctantly admit. Ugh, this b4 is coming. My queen's in the wrong place. Can I get my queen out of here? I don't want it there. Like target practice for some tempos. I just want it away from this. I need something to do here, don't I? I'm not sure what to do at the moment. Hold on a sec. Is knight e4 any good? I'm compromising my king to get a knight on e4. What else? Hang on. Let's just treble on b3 for a laugh. Alekhine's gone on b3. So rook b7, queen d8 to b8. Any b4 in that scenario, I think, just loses a pawn. Well, that's a piece blunder. Sorry. That wasn't too good, was it? Blundering a piece. Sorry. As I was about to do an Alakine's gun. Okay. All right, thanks, Mikhtar. Thanks. Thanks for the game. Simba. Hi there. Did he press the tick box for creating a new game? Did he press the tick box? Looking at my book, The Sorcerer's Apprentice. I don't know if you can see this. This is, if you want a great book, Bronstein, he was a great challenger to Mikhail Botvinnik. I think some of the games probably threw, I mean, probably forced through. I don't know. There seemed to be political pressure at the time, but he's a great player. We'll do a book review at the end, okay? So that's one of the books I want to mention. Let's abort this game. Maybe we can challenge again later. Work hard, play hard. The queen is at the beginning of the gun. Yeah, I think the queen is then followed by the two rooks in the Anakin's gun is almost. Transposing into a pan of Botvinnik against the Caracan, I think. The Caracan pan of Botvinnik system. Trying to punish the bishop away from b7. Try and punish the queen on d7 with knight e5. I think I'll play knight e5 here. I think d5 is under pressure. I'm forking queen and bishop. I'm using the pin. I'm using the queen on d7. If takes takes, knight moves, and the queen d5 might be possible. I have to check this out. This looks quite forcing. I seem to be. I'm trying to punish my opponent's earlier moves. Basically. D5 seems to be hanging. Some tactic I'm going into. I don't know. It doesn't look likely. There's also knight takes here. Is probably a good time to check out even the outrageous forcing move sequences because it's the sort of position where there could be a wipeout forcing move sequence quite easily without any positional compromises. I mean, takes, 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 d5. Now, if takes here, d takes, queen takes, 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 have a better pawn structure. There might be other ways of playing this. Threatening knight takes to win the queen. If takes takes d5. If takes takes, if takes takes. I think I end up with a better pawn structure. I might even end up with an extra pawn, you never know. But at minimum, I think I get better pawn structure. I'm threatening queen takes on takes with a pawn or queen. And the g file is a bit scary. And there's queen h5 to think about. I probably should have played that earlier. There's now rook g8. Although rook g6, queen h7, rook g7. There's bishop a7 for nick another pawn. Oh, was just for a moment. Yeah, I might just take that pawn if it's not moved. Okay. So yeah, it looks like okay, hitting my queen. So queen g7 is interesting. Sorry, I'm crouching down a bit too much over there. If he takes it, I'm wondering if like bishop g7 at some point would be useful. Maybe bishop f6, king f6, rook d6. So bishop g7, bishop f6, rook d6. Do I worry about, I don't worry about bishop h2 too much. My back row is a bit vulnerable, potentially. On rook e5, I'm just going to take that and take it here. On rook c8, I'm going to play g3, I think. Rook e8, okay. Taking it here. And just sort out my back row for a moment. Fix the pawns. There's also rook g7 to g7. I mean rook g7 to g5 and outside h pawn. The only thing rook d2 and e3 plan will try and win f2. So this e3 plan maybe have to be concerned. So this plan. Maybe, like, as soon as that moves, I play this. And, okay, I can use a bit of time for this passed pawn here on king f5, h5, rook b3, h6, while stopping e3. I see, this is not so easy, is it? I've got to admit, it's not so easy. This pawn's a liability. It's a liability. I can easily lose that pawn here and lose the whole advantage, technically, of the position. All right, I'll go for the e4 pawn of king g6. Well, I think Rook G8 here. All right, thanks for the game. Oh, that was friend's request. Okay, Don G. Oh, I've just played the other kind of fence. I have played it before. It's okay. No panic. I mean. Yeah, it's sort of provocative, isn't it? The Alakon defense. It was used in the 1972 World Championship match by Fischer in one or two of the games with some success. Trying to undermine the center a bit. Giving up the bishop pair, which, yes, is a double-edged thing to do, to give up. I don't like, as I say, necessarily giving up the light square bishop, but okay, I'm blocking in my own c pawn, I know. Sometimes you don't need the c pawn to move, I guess. You know what? Knight b4 seems tempting. If the bishop moves, I'd take on c4. Bite the center a bit with c6. It takes, I take, and in some way I think pieces are more active than they were. In some way also I think the pawn structure is a little bit more exposed. Yeah, okay, well c4's hanging here, weakness of the last move. You can almost do another arrow for a weakness of the last move, by the way. It's one of my favorite things that you could have these grand plans in chess, but actually also look like a hawk at the move-to-move goings on in detail, because they often just give you the answer. Just the latest move gives you the answer. It's almost an analogy if you do software and the latest code has some bugs in it. You want to sort of look at the latest code you've just put in to a system. Sometimes that's just the thing, because the position is like tested previously, so it's like the new stuff which is untested. So here, anyway, I haven't yet blown up the center, so well, I mean it's well on the way. Probably this one, just to play takes and knight e5. No, hang on. If I take, I lose c5. That's a nice pawn chain to maintain for a moment. Could I just take on b2 if the bishop moves? Now let's say the bishop moves to f2. Yeah, bishop moves to f2. Do I dare take that, or is the knight just getting trapped? It's too materialistic. I should be happy enough with my extra pawn. Yeah, the whole okay, I'm on a sec. Now, I don't want to lose c5, right? And I don't necessarily want to play knight b2 because I think queen b3. And I don't want to play that. So, by process of elimination, what do I want to do actually? Is it interesting? I'm thinking, do I strengthen c5 so I can play this? The knight can go back. Yeah. I'll try this. Am I going to lose a knight now? That's the question. Because queen a4, yeah. But, there is knight a5 and b4 and it gets complicated. Maybe. Okay, I'm going to weaken e5 now. I'll give the knight something to do just before it gets lost to queen a4. Or do I move this knight? I don't know. This is decisions. I don't know. The queen a4. I'm thinking I should be worrying about queen a4. So yeah, just in case queen a4. Do something about it in advance. I don't know. It's strange. I'm thinking. Okay, yeah. These things are getting interesting. Things are hotting up now. These knights are. They need to be finding safe locations. These knights. I'm hitting the h3. No, I don't want to open up that bishop necessarily. Although you notice that is a forcing move, but it opens up an opponent's piece. You see, the golden law of bad forcing moves, where you open up or untangle or increase the activity of any of the opponent's pieces, should not be regarded as a tiny downside. So if I take on h3. And the knights, okay, they're protected by the pawn structure here. Okay, can I just double now? And if I target f4, it's not very convincing to target f4. I think the knights want to do something. This knight can come down to h5, actually. My queen can also get trapped in the meantime with rook h1. Now I can also lose on time pretty soon. I better speed up. Better speed up a bit. Oh, my king safety is now in question after rook h5. Sets up a positional blockade. Use the other knight. H5. Queen c2. Take the queens off. Bishop d4. Scary. Queen d3. Less scary. Thanks for the game, Don. Thanks for the game, Don. Knight killer. My knight's just got nearly killed in the previous game, but now I'm playing against a professional knight killer. So I had to be even more wary about my knights. Those knights. Let's still play c5, Benko Gambit style. Take some space anyway, even though c4 hasn't been played. I think this is an interesting idea now to promote Bishop d2 as a disruption and simply slide the queen back after. Isn't this just winning a piece? Because a3, ab, there's no ab because of queen a1. I don't know, my 1970 computer engine calculation in my head is pretty flawed. It's the equivalent of a ZX 81, but if we just go through this slowly, a3, okay, there's that. It bypasses the whole thing. I'm preferring this to d8 for a moment. Because I'm holding e5. Hugging e5? Is that a bad way of saying it? Holding, hugging, whatever. It's on e5. I don't know why. Sorry. I don't know about hugging e5. I don't know where that came from. Okay, so bishop g7. Okay, so maybe knight b6, a4, a3 to get some dark square weenies. There's nothing funny about this position. I don't know why I find it amusing. Sorry. I just, what's going on here? All right. A4, A3 could be on the dark squares. Yeah. Oh God. Okay, A3. I'm just trying to get these dark squares going, yeah? I don't know, I'm locking down the whole position though, if A3. Dark squares are mine. Yes, I've got enough pawns and dark squares now. I've got a dark square bishop. It hasn't even got a counterpart. Yeah, the dark square strategy. But the thing is, it's a closed position over there. It's a closed position. So it's no big deal, really. No big deal at the moment. Let's create some weaknesses. So I'll create a weakness on e6. But I'll try and cover it up and try and get the upsides of this without all the million downsides, like weakening e6. That's going to be hard to do because h6, knight h4, and my light squares could be falling to bits pretty soon. Yes, this is getting dangerous. It's not funny anymore. This is getting dangerous. It's not amusing. It's not funny. I think King H7 was Knight F5, and I'm not laughing after that. I'd rather have my king. It's pretty, safe if possible. Really, I've got to redeploy this. Bishop c8, g5. All right, I'm not losing f5 for the moment. F4, there's knight g4. Everything's going to backfire on the light squares soon, isn't it? Basically. Oh, let's play this like for e6, going across the center to the king. Queen here, e6 is possible, trying to undermine d5. At the very least, I can get to play e5 without en passant because I had to take on h1. If I can get to play e5, then I can play. Well, I can't play f4 because of knight g4. I can't play e4 because of f3, so it's not exactly lucrative, but it's just a thought that e5 might have been useful. Queen a8 for e5. This is not convincing. The only thing I can say about that is that en passant is ruled out. As far as I'm aware, white doesn't want to lose the bishop on h1. So e5, e4, with tempo. This is the problem with having a pawn on e4. It's encouraging undermining. I've actually got a student at the moment. I've seen that in a lot of his games. He creates these structures in over the board which are prone to undermining. And I don't want to do exactly the same thing here, but okay, let's do this. Let's do this. It opens up the bishop and queen. He doesn't want to take in principle here, does he? I've got such a big clock advantage in practice anyway. I'm not sure this is going to last too long at the moment. Okay, it's still a lot of battle ahead, really. Okay, thanks for the game, Night Killer. So my knights survived to tell the tale there. Okay, Luke. Hi there. Ooh. I'll stick with the Smith more. Five-minute game, see what happens. In book at the moment, inverted commas, sort of my tiny little book for what I can remember. Bishop g4, bishop e2 is possible. There's a bishop f3, queen d4, bishop c6 takes, and then queen d4. So bishop e2. I've seen even IMs, they don't know the theory, they play bishop e3. You can play bishop e2 here against this because you've got the tactic bishop c6 with queen d4. Bishop h4 to g3. Seems a comfortable position. I'm getting the idea the opponent might not always play this opening. Suppose so. Just losing a pawn. That's unfortunate if I am. Looks as though I'm just losing a pawn. Okay. I'm not a, don't know about this anymore. I could be just losing a pawn. Yeah. Ah, I'm gonna lose all my pawns in this game. This doesn't look right now. Something unfortunate about this. Hang on. Queen here. Knight a4. What does he do? Knight d4? I can win my queen off the knight at three and rook d2. Knight b6, knight f3, g takes, rook d2. Isn't there like knight takes rook there? Alright, it doesn't do any of that, of course. So back to losing pawn on e5. Can I get compensation or not? There's also knight c2 threatened the way I played it. This is the pawn down, yeah. Oh, great. This is just fantastic. Okay. I'll stop knight c2 for the moment. Yeah, I don't like those games where just end up losing the isolated pawn and then getting ground down in the end game. They're not my most entertaining form of games, but anyway, so let's see if I get ground down or not. So there's knight d4 here, knight e3, knight f5. Does that do anything? Knight f5 after. Oh, maybe. Maybe there's bishop f3. Opposite colored bishops. If he wants to take my bishop and protect that pawn, it is an opposite colored bishops. Trying to get my pawns off the light, the dark squares. Set up some sort of fortress with bishop c6. Okay, two. Don't want too much pressure on F2. I guess I can. Play rook f3 though, on doubling and bishop d4. I play rook f3, super passive. He's a bit slow though. I was getting a bishop to c5 at this rate. I just want a bishop d6, rook a1 now. Bishop c5, king h2. Might have a5 for targeting a7. What does this do? See that? That's pretty unfortunate. My rook is also not helping my back row at all. Oh dear. Oh. Back row's been destroyed. I don't know what to do. Oh dear. I don't know. There's nothing to do. Hopeless. Four seconds as well. Doesn't help. Yeah, we'll play. Oof. That was, yeah, tough. Okay. Jorgen. Is Jorgen ready? Is your gonna really okay? Maybe okay. Give this a moment. Okay, bought that. Done, man. Let's play King's Gambit. By the way, I know it might look as I'm crying. Actually, I need to use an optimist. I've got optimist. I know there's ambiguity here if I'm crying over the last game. But yeah, I forgot to use optimist recently. I've been using a lot of the computer recently, so that's my excuse if I look as I'm crying. I shouldn't have that much to cry about. I mean, I haven't lost 6 million games yet, but just in case you're wondering. Okay, so on that note, yeah, bishop f6. Oh dear, oh dear. Okay. I suffer from dry eyes. Yeah. It's good to be able to lose because in chess, it's a game of losing and winning. Yeah, it's a game of sadism and masochism. Yeah, so it's good to be good at both, just in case. Yeah. But yeah, no, I've got always that dry out bit sometimes. So yeah, Optrex do this thing, Actimist for dry and irritated eyes. Sometimes that helps. Now, Rook F6, H6, maybe just Bishop F6. Yeah. Yeah, maybe just hold this knight here for a moment. Things seem to be going okay here. H4, H5, H6. I could demonstrate how Optimus works actually, if you want, if you're fascinated. You actually have it on closed. You have it on closed eyelids. Actually, it's best to spray it first before using it. I haven't used it for a few days. That should last. That should last a few hours, actually. Okay, so okay, Bishop B1. I don't want to get back row mated. That would be upsetting. Okay, so I'll try and make some air for the king. Oh, Simba, hi Simba. Did you want to re-challenge after? I'm carrying on at the moment. There's a lot of challenges actually today. I thought you guys were caught unaware from the hour change, but apparently not. That's good. I mean, that's great. Just to get peace off with Bishop E6, D rookie, just to get peace off because I'm threatening mate. I'll put Bishop on D5 here, I think. Okay, this looks to be winning more material now. Okay, thanks, Dan man. Aldisto, next. Hi there. I'm gonna throw away the Smith Mora though. Nothing to do with the previous loss. No, okay. What's this C5? This is an unusual Vienna game. Have I pinned that? This looks like a quirky little pawn structure here. Looks like a cross between a Benoni and Sicilian Neidorf. Can I not just roll the center down with e5, which is sort of sometimes a thematic kind of break? But here I've also got an f-file pressure building up. It looks as though developments Not great. If I can use the F file, I'll be very happy. That's interesting. So it takes this check, yes, okay, I see that. Let me my king. If knight f6, there's a check here actually for knight f7, forking two rooks and the queen. If knight e7, I'll probably take it here. If b6, I might play queen e2. Bishop b5. There is knight g5. What about just knight g5? No. I don't believe it. F5, knight f7 gives me at the minimum knight d6 check. This F file looks dangerous for black. I've also got this, these glasses. Actually, thankfully, they gave me a silk thing. I mean, you can get it, but I don't know. It's better to use a silky, whatever it is. What's that called? I don't know. So, okay, there's knight f7 in this position. If takes here, there's knight d6, isn't there? Yeah, thanks for the game, Aldisto. Thanks for the game. Yeah, it looks like a dodgy opening, actually. There are established ways to sort of equalize quite easily against the Vienna game, unfortunately. But they do exist, and the Vienna game player takes that risk every time they play it. That if black knows, yeah, there's established ways to get quite a good position with black against the Vienna game, unfortunately. But I find it sometimes a little bit of a surprise weapon in my blitz, aggressive blitz repertoire, the Vienna game. Anything to avoid the Royal Lepez, which is like the most theoretically documented opening. So I've actually got three main threads can vary between the Vienna game, the Scotch game at the moment, and the King's Gambit for fun, entertaining, aggressive blitz games, just to avoid the Royal Lepez. Okay, so should we abort this game? Maybe you can challenge later. Simba, we got down to you. Hello. I'll dare play the King's Gambit. Sorry, did I mention the King's Gambit as well? That's another one, yeah. Can I play that? Yeah. Just to stop Bishop G4, actually. Oh, this is a 3 minute game. Oh, great. 3 minute game. Pre-move here for knight f3, sorting out Queen f3. This is a safe, what I call a safe pre-move, because it's kind of illegal otherwise on anything other than knight f3. And if you want to become a bullet specialist, it's good to distinguish between safe pre-moves and controversial ones, as in forcing moves. It's good to distinguish between good forcing moves and ones which give the opponent tiny little things and side effects you didn't want. Okay, so Queen d2 here. I'm not sure I mind that. Maybe I just take action on knight e2. And do I drop b2 here? Try and trap the bishop. There's bishop f7 for queen b3. At the center. And queen b3. We'll just castle. Just castle. And play e5. Well, he's got takes and then taking the queen. Is there a better approach here than e5? Maybe knight g3 for knight h5. Just using that pin. Yeah, that looks very tasty. Knight g3 to h5. If I got the chance, that is. Do that. Right, for the moment, I'm still playing from knight g3 to h5. Well, there's bishop g3 here on the rook. It's only an exchange, and it actually weakens my dark squares because he's got his bishop there. So, do I actually want to do that? Probably not. Because it's a blitz game. As I say, having an easy to play position should be given a high priority. Easier way of playing the position in blitz might be bishop e5. Because if the knight moves, there's knight f4 and I'm on d5. This might be easier. Let him move the rook. Knight f4. He's not moving the rook. Queen hanging. Yeah, thanks for the game, Simon. That's a bit too. They seem a little bit more superficial to me. Oh, I've got to decline this non-member. So, Bernard, I think we can call it day. I'll have to do a quick book review after, if you want. Because I think we've done our scheduled bit and I've got some books I might as well mention. I mean, when I say I'm not in depth book review, just I'll just show you some table of contents, basically, I think, which is allowed, I think. Maybe just the one, maybe just one, a different one next time. Sorcerer's Apprentice, since I mentioned it, maybe. I'm looking at Bronstein at the moment in my Evolution of Chess Style series on YouTube. And yeah, he's dynamic, aggressive, and seems to enjoy chess as a game rather than a sort of, don't know, Botvinnik's kind of serious. He didn't play too much blitz chess, Botvinnik. He says, there's this quotation, yeah, I played blitz on the train or something, and that was it. But I think other world champions and contenders did enjoy other aspects of the game, like blitz, other sort of variations. But anyway, yeah, Bronstein, interesting character, very interesting, very interesting. Knight f8 to e6. Sorry, yeah, I seem to have played a lot longer than 1.5 hours. Yeah, I'm sorry. What 12 a.m. Yeah, this would be the last game. May I don't know. I'll quickly mention this button then. Okay. Knight F4 looks like an idea. And possibly Bishop F5, Bishop E4. Or Bishop G4 for doubling the pawns here. Yeah, safe pre-move, but he's not going to do that. I mean, is he? All right, he's giving me double pawns though to play with. I think, was that a mistake? That seems to be a mistake, really. Losing a piece to end the exchange. I'll play for Bishop G3 when the time is ripe. Maybe here, Bishop G3 for Rook E3. I don't believe that. There's Bishop G3 anyway for Queen G3 and Rook E2. Queen. I'll be greedy and take a pawn first before taking the queen. Right, thanks for the game. Okay, maybe we can add this as a new feature rather than the auto content. So I'll just quickly mention this book. I don't know if any of you have got it. Yeah, I think it is interesting. I dip into this from time to time. So he's got combinations, games with comments, games with diagrams, picturesque games, good indexes, index to opponents, index to openings. So basically, yeah, Bronstein was a challenger that actually had a level score against Botvinnik. So many say he could have been, a world champion, and he's done some classic works of chess literature. Zurich, was it Bronstein? Okay. So anyway, but this is definitely interesting if you want an interesting book. Sorcerer's Apprentice. There's something about his dynamic games that really appeal to me, I would like to say. So anyway, that was a very quick. We can have a more detailed review of a book next time if you want. Actually, I've already played for like a couple of hours. So until next time, yeah, I hope you enjoyed this session. But yeah, that's my book recommendation, not book review. Book recommendations, we call it. Okay, so thanks for coming and have a good week. Have a good rest of the weekend and have a good week. Good luck on your chess. Enjoy your chess, etc., etc. So see you next week. Okay, comments, questions, likes, appreciate it. Thanks very much. Cheers then.